Hey everyone, and welcome back to the Warcraft News. It's one that's ended up being a lot more wild and wacky than I first thought, because the mad lads at Blizzard have just went and gone and nerfed water. That sure was a surprise. They've also lost a major office, which we need to get into. They have changed up conduits and legendaries. They've made a very, very, very strange change to Covenant abilities and a bunch of other things, including some lovely lore. So even if half of this video is going to be utter chaos, we are going to talk about, well, the people who literally created the universe, because that came out. Yeah, pretty wild. And speaking of cool stuff, Rogue Pin, it's on Patreon this month, and while the pin is not yet in the office, as I think is befitting a rogue, here is how it's, grown up since you've last seen it in our little preview. Yeah, it's coming together, pretty cool to see. I'm also happy to announce that we are doing a fresh run of one of our most popular specials. It is these guys. Many of you loved these the last time, and you know what? The whole Patreon situation has grown so much that we thought it would be a good time to do another run of them for that nostalgia hit, give people an opportunity. We're also, of course, spooking things up with this month's art as well, and we've also even got snazzy new packaging, which we've been able to do. That was very fun. Thank you for everything. I mean, seriously, your support has directly created two new jobs since September. That's pretty awesome, and all goes back into the content. So, thank you, and let's go. First up, the French situation, and this is real stuff, okay? Blizzard is losing, they're closing their office in France. Now, this office was their European HQ, and believe me, this is a pretty big move. This was their main presence in the EU, and it has been run by Blizzard independently since its inception quite a number of years ago. Now, already 134 of the 400 roles at that building were axed with the 2019 sort of big cut, right? Remember the big Activision Blizzard layoff wave. So it's been a strange situation for those staff since, but it does seem like the rest of the jobs are now actually up for being cut as well. Now, currently, staff do not know if they will be offered new roles, and they're basically just being expected to trundle on with their jobs, knowing that something spooky is going to happen to them in the near future. And I mean, that's obviously what's happening because, of course, I work with people on that team, and last I checked, they're still sending me beta keys and, you know, giving me PR kits and stuff like that. So they're still trucking along, and it just seems like we don't really know externally what's going to be going on. Now, earlier on this year, there actually were some rumblings that I think a whole bunch of people could confirm, of there being some sort of plan to close the France office and to move its roles outside of Blizzard Entertainment. The plan there was actually for the parent organization, Activision Blizzard, who of course handle Call of Duty and, you know, Candy Crush, things like that, basically for things to be moving over to the London Activision Blizzard office. Now, according to Bloomberg, that plan is actually in jeopardy because of COVID and Brexit-related concerns, making London seem like a bit of an iffy proposition to the decision-makers at ActiBliz. Now, Patrick Beja, who is, of course, co-host of The Instance, the longest-running, I believe, World of Warcraft podcast ever, he used to work at that office, and he did post a very useful Twitter thread. And he basically talked about how this directly shifts a number of core responsibilities to Activision, if it is to happen, and that Activision run things quite a bit differently to Blizzard, and the Blizzard are very much developer-led. And I actually have, I think, an example of that. Remember Pepe, right? The cute bird from the Warlords of Draenor expansion. Well, I heard rumblings that the reason why he was removed from the Blizzard gear store was apparently at the request of the WoW dev team. Now, it's like info that I would trust, and I guess as to why that happened, I can personally think of one of two things. Maybe they were a bit worried about, of course, the popular cartoon frog of the internet and the same name being shared between the two of them, or maybe them just wanting to remove kind of like cutesy things from the store, because I did notice at the time a bunch of cutesy things like that, and I think like some of the leggings and stuff that were a bit less like orcs and swords kind of got taken out. So hard to know what's going on there, but point is, via Patrick, that a lot of things were actually surprisingly developer-led at Blizzard, and that this change of responsibilities from the Blizzard France office over to some sort of shared Activision Blizzard unit, like the one that already exists in London, that would obviously be a loss of control for Blizzard, and therefore it literally would be things going to Activision. That's basically it. And this would mean that more things would be basically led by, you know, PR and stuff. Now, as you know, a while ago, I covered tweets from Tips Out, a classic streamer, who basically tweeted that a Blizzard dev talked to him and that dev talked about Activision moving in and how what we've seen, you know, the headlines and websites like Kotaku is basically just the tip of the iceberg. Now, I can also confirm, of course, as I've said in the past, that I did speak to a Blizzard developer last year, and that individual was very sad about how things were going. And overall, it does seem that, yes, the core of this point is that the decision-making power is shifting away from the development teams, and as Jason Schreier reported in a lot of his reporting on Blizzard back when he was still with Kotaku, a lot of that's moving over to finance and different departments, and the Blizzard is basically about cutting all, like, non-essential costs and doubling down on the development resources. So that's really the key point here. This is just more of Activision moving in. In this case, a Blizzard office is going, and those roles are going to be taken up by some sort of Activision Blizzard office, it seems. Is this a good thing? I would say no. I don't think it is a good thing whatsoever. You know, I mean, I'm now wondering, who will my point of contact be at Blizzard? Will the person that I, you know, talk to and the EU people talk to when we coordinate, will they still have a job? We do not know. And to be clear there, the EU team has always been pretty awesome to work with. It really seems like they were never given the budget they deserved, but they always, as individuals, did pull through and try as hard as they could to do right by us, as I guess the people they were working with. So it's a little bit rough. Now, it is also the case that they're in France. French labor laws are pretty good for the workers, so they probably will get excellent severance packages. Certainly, if you're looking at what they're going to get from a US context, you'll probably be slightly flabbergasted. And perhaps that's one of the reasons why Activision Blizzard actually would not like to be open in that country, because, well, you know, it's very worker-friendly, which in some cases is not as business-friendly, if they are going to want to be as cutthroat as they sometimes do want to be. Overall here, Blizzard used to be extremely independent. That's decreased over time. It will continue to decrease. And also, don't blame Ian and Co. for everything, right? It's the sort of thing, when Blitzchung happened, Blizzard employees protested to their own company. There's one example. I mean, hey, the person who's working at a petrol station, do you blame them for big oil? No. There's a lot of great people at Blizzard who are just trying to do their jobs and make games that they love. This stuff ain't on them. But certainly, it does bode rather badly, and then we also must remember that Mike Morhaime set up Dreamhaven, like, literally, he did that when his non-compete expired. So that's pretty telling. It's not like he was wandering the abyss, wondering what to do with his life. It really seems like he quit Blizzard, you know, and just as soon as this thing went, he just set up a new company. So I don't know. Doesn't bode well for Blizzard, and certainly I wish all the staff affected the very best in these, probably for them, very difficult times. The patch 9.0.1 official patch notes have a strange detail. I'll read it for you. Water now regenerates mana slower in the first seconds you begin drinking, increasing to a rapid return as you drink continuously. Yep, quick sips have been nerfed. Why? What? Hello? This is a big increase in healer stress, in my opinion. Sometimes you're a healer, you're in a sticky situation, you want a quick glug while that tank is zooming off somewhere because you just want a little bit more mana. Or, you know, maybe you've just killed a mob and you just want one or two glugs before you try the next one in the open world, as an example. Not that that's really a thing for most classes, but still, this is a bit weird. This is a quality of life downgrade to getting mana back in general use cases. That's just what it is, right? I mean, this certainly makes the act of clicking the drink button and having the upshot of that button, you know, makes that less responsive. So that's a bit weird. I mean, often you do just want a quick top up of mana, and it seems like that is being nerfed a little bit. Now, these nerfs must be viewed in the context of Blizzard being these sort of habitual problem solvers. As I sort of said, sometimes they solve problems even though it may not be to the greater good of the player experience. So what are the problems that this could solve? Well, it's a nerf to two things in my mind. It's a nerf to healers who sneak away for a quick drink in PvP. Maybe they feel like that's not balanced in 3v3 arenas. I did see some Twitter comments mention something about a recent arena match, but I don't actually watch, you know, the competitive arena stuff. I don't really care that much. So I don't know if you're a PvPer. Maybe you understand this a bit more. And also, it could be a nerf to healers who just want a quick drink in between packs in Mythic Plus gameplay, which is fine, but then you do have to kind of wonder, is this to punish them? Why do they deserve to be punished? How are they doing something that was not intended? Is this supposed to slow down the rate of pulls, perhaps, in Mythic Plus? And if that is the case, then, I mean, I could understand maybe in an MDI competitive sort of perspective wanting to do that, but in the real world, for the vast majority of players, I mean, good luck getting pug tanks to actually follow along with that. So it just seems to me like this is going to really stress out healers, and that's a role that already stresses people out quite a bit. Why? I mean, I think those may be the reasons. Is that worth it? Is this a bit pointless? Do a lot of people see Shadowlands has been delayed and then look at this list of changes and think, why is it being delayed? Is this really what you're doing? Now, I would say that I doubt that these changes were what it was delayed for, obviously, but that's going to be a lot of the perspective. It's going to be what people actually sort of think when they see these things. So I don't know, man. Seems a bit strange to me. And again, this and the Covenant abilities not being used outside of the core Shadowlands content. To me, I see these two changes and I'm like, why? I understand there could be some small problems you're solving with this, but why? How is this to the greater benefit of the player experience for the average player? I don't know. Seems weird. Let me know what you think, and let's move on to something that's actually fun. We have some fun new lore courtesy of course, Ian Bates, red shirt guy. We all know him and love him from BlizzCon, and he got, seemingly, his Shadowlands press kit, a copy of the collector's edition, before we did. So, grats to him. And when that happened, he opened up the art book. He read the art book, and he found some really cool bits of lore, as Ian does. So, let's get into it. The first ones. Here's a quote. The first ones who shaped the cosmos knew they needed to protect the Shadowlands from external threats from beyond. Maldraxxus was their answer. There you go. The first ones shaped the cosmos. That's it. They made the whole shebang. That's what it seems to be, right? Do the first ones predate the Titans, the Pantheon of Death, the whole everyone? Yeah, it seems that that's actually the case. Them being pre-Titan also is in line with the visual design of World of Warcraft 2, because if you look at things like Ouroboros and like the Waystone and stuff, it looks Titanic, but it looks like older than Titanic stuff. So there you go. The first ones sort of made everything. And this has got really big implications. We're not going to get into all of them, but it seems obvious that they ordered the Shadowlands. And I then have to wonder, like, did they create the Titans? And if they did create the Titans, you know, were they the Titans' source of inspiration when the Titans then went to, order the cosmos, order the material plane? All extremely interesting stuff. Next up, we've got one on the role of the Arbiter. So here it is. Without her, souls would be lost within the infinite realms of the Shadowlands. I think that's pretty cool. So the whole thing, right, is you die, you go to the Shadowlands, and she sends you off somewhere. And if she didn't exist, you'd just be floating around, I guess, in the infinite realms, right? Just this energy soup. And of course, this very much does suggest what we, I think, pretty much already did know anyway, which is that the Arbiter was created by the First Ones for this purpose. So yes, the First Ones ordered the Shadowlands, and I do have to wonder then, are the First Ones natives to the Shadowlands, or are they just the people who set it all up? And if that is the case, then surely the First Ones, you know, ordered and set up whatever is going on in life, in Fel, in all of the other different realms, including perhaps Order, which then makes you think Titan Homeworld, Titan Homeplane. You think about those Steve Denuser Q&As, and oh dear, your brain kind of explodes because, as Ian said, we're zooming out from that cosmology chart. Pretty neat. Next up, we've got the Ember Ward. Now that is the big light scarred bit of Revendreth. Here's the quote. The Ember Ward shall forever bear the scars of the light's unjust strike against the Venthyr. To even humor the idea that our beloved sire did anything to incur the light's wrath would be an act of sedition. Well, that's kind of fun because we know that Denathrius is an absolute dickhead and a definite bad guy. He's our first end raid boss. So it makes sense that the light went and tried to strike out against them. Now, I would say, here's our big thing. Did the light strike out against the Sire or against the Shadowlands? That's one question. Another one, is this vengeance for the Naru the Denathrius captured, or was this Naru captured after, as a part of Denathrius beating back this incursion from the light? Either way, I think it's pretty interesting. We do see light and void incursions into the Shadowlands, which of course does make you do a big thing. So that's pretty neat. Then next up, we've got the Maw, and look, there's mentions in it that the crimes of those in the Maw cannot compare to those of the Jailer. I think that's pretty neat. They're basically setting it up so that the Jailer did some form of massive betrayal. It seems like the Jailer did something truly despicable to end up where he is. We, of course, do not know whatever he did. Seemingly, it's a betrayal of the rest of the Pantheon, right? Of the Primus and the Winter Queen, the Archon and co, Denathrius, of course. But we don't know what that is yet. Seemingly, though, it was a real dick move, and that's why he is down there in the Maw. So that's pretty cool. Sylvanas, let's go to her next. So it actually makes mention of the Jailer sending the Valkyr to her in Edge of Night, so there's that, very, very confirmed, and that basically they were her tethers to mortality. And it also makes it pretty clear that Bolvar is a false king, and that Sylvanas' big job was to claim his crown. Yeah. Here's another one as well. The veil between realms wanes. The helm of domination was crafted to be our way forward. Instead, the one seared by the flames of life uses it to keep us at bay. Now that's a big line, because if you've watched our Lich King video, which by the way, I think it's one of the best ones we've ever done. The team did such a great job, man. Oh, those edits, they're so creamy. But that video, right? Like, one of the big things was about this, really diving into Bolvar kind of screwing up the entire plan of the Jailer with the Lich King. And this line is directly referencing Bolvar in the same way that we believe the plot line to be. So this very much does confirm, like, our big Lich King video. And I think that means, if you've not watched it, definitely watch it. It's pretty cool. But yeah, Bolvar, the dude was just too strong for the helm to dominate him. Was he? Was he too strong? Or is it the fact that he was actually touched by the flames of life because it was Alexstrasza that made him the way that he was, and that indeed, as it says in Enemy Incursion, the Dreadlord book, that life is one of the most insidious opponents that death has, which then would mean that, yeah, whatever Alexstrasza did perhaps made Bolvar way more strong to the dominating powers of that helm. So there you go. That is some lore from the Shadowlands art book. Certainly, I can't wait to get the art book, and I know that whenever we get the art books, it's always fun, like, sending them over right through that wall to the game dev team so they can have a look at them. We've used them quite a bit as, you know, bits of inspiration, so it's all pretty cool. Anyway, that's it. Let's move on. Then next up for the news, we've got the wild situation of Covenant abilities being deactivated outside of the Shadowlands, and then the reversion of that. And then, what's even more important, Ian Hazzacostas' reasoning for basically why this entire thing happened in the first place. So, if you're not aware, in a recent beta build, it appeared that, yes, your Covenant abilities couldn't be used outside of the Shadowlands. So, if you, say, were a Night Fae whatever, then if you just went to Orgrimmar, you couldn't use your Night Fae abilities, and that would include your class ability and the signature ability. A lot of people thought this sucked. In fact, almost everybody thought that this sucked. The forums were pretty quickly flooded, and Ian Hazzacostas has actually responded, and he basically said that the team themselves were on the fence about this change, and that ultimately the feedback they've received has made it pretty clear that it was the wrong direction. Now, I think the reason why many people felt that was the wrong direction is because it was somewhat changing up the identity of their character. The idea that, you know, you've got this stuff that is a part of your class, and then you move somewhere else, and then it's gone, that kind of erodes it being a part of your character. Now, that is all quite funny, because, of course, Ian said that in this expansion, one of their goals was, you know, for you to be a Kyrian paladin. Right? And I think that if you're a paladin and you change zones and your Kyrian abilities go away, you're not going to feel like a Kyrian paladin. I think you can quite obviously see how that's a pretty jarring experience that even goes against some of Blizzard's own stated goals. However, Blizzard's reasoning actually does show that there's a problem that we've experienced before, that we will experience again, and that they appear to be very aware of. So Ian actually said that this is something the team put in because they've been toying around with how to make these core expansion features be more tied to that expansion's content, such that when players end up, of course, leaving that expansion's content, they don't feel like their class has been changed in a sort of surprising way. And of course, that's very much referencing what happened when we lost our Legion artifacts, right? We were super powerful, then our artifacts went away, we went into BFA, and we felt pretty terrible. And this is where the conversation about borrowed power really, really did come up. And people started to say, like, hey, you know, my class, it changes through this expansion, and then we throw it all in the bin. And then we do it again for another expansion, and then we throw all that in the bin. And now we're in the Shadowlands expansion. We're going to get all of our borrowed power with our confidence and our conduits and our soul binds. And what's going to happen at the end of that? We're going to throw all of that in the bin. Blizzard, basically, with this change, were trying to see if they could preempt the throwing of the expansion's borrowed power in the bin by getting people very used to the idea that those powers only made sense in and only worked in the Shadowlands-related content. But I think you can see how, from a just day-to-day gameplay perspective, that doesn't really work. And what I find interesting here personally is, I mean, man, the fact that Ian's making that post, it shows that he knows what the problem with borrowed power is, right? I read that, and in the office, you know, me, Matt, and Jared were sitting in the room, and we were just thinking to each other, guys, you're so close to getting it, that maybe this borrowed power is not the best thing for the long-term health of the game. Now, I can absolutely agree that at the very start of the Legion expansion, when we got this big surge of new stuff, yeah, it felt pretty good. People were pretty excited. But I think we're beginning to see that across the long term, it's maybe not the most healthy way to be developing the game. Certainly, if you've heard a lot of my coverage lately or Preach's coverage, a lot of it is us just saying, like, guys, you're here, you're trying to reinvent the wheel again and again and again. Is it really worth all the time that it's taking up? And personally, I have to wonder if what happened is they just saw that the artifact weapons, like, I think they were a real Hail Mary, right? Because WoW was in such a bad place after Warlords of Draenor, and it kind of needed something extremely just crazy as a big new title feature to get people in and get them hyped. I think that's what happened with Legion, but I think we're just seeing that while that may have been the play for then, it's not the long-term way to develop this game. I actually suspect that Ian is maybe close to agreeing based off the verbiage of his blue post, right? How he actually sort of worded it seems to be very aware that this is a looming problem in the horizon. And I would just say, Blizz, if you felt the need to preempt a problem that's going to happen in 2 years by making changes to the beta of this expansion, so preempting the removal of borrowed power, feeling bad before you've even added the borrowed power to the live game, I mean, maybe that just shows that we should be thinking a little bit differently in terms of how these things go. Really, though, I'm going to kick this over to you. Borrowed power systems, do you think that they are something that should be in the game in a very big way, like with the artifacts, or maybe in the game in a small way that's a bit more controlled? Or do you think that we should maybe just abandon this stuff a little bit more and go back to a more old school sort of development? I'd love to hear what you've got to say. All right, we've got loads of smaller stories to go through. So, the alt skip has been added for the Covenant intro quests. That's something that's happened. This won't save that much time for the Necrolords, who have a really, really quick Covenant onboarding experience, but it will save lots of time for the Night Fae, and certainly this will be popular with alt players who just want to go and get on with it. That said, I think the only other thing that we need is a skip to the Maw, but actually thinking about the skip of the Maw intro, and skips of expansion intros are a normal thing that Blizzard does, but thinking about that skip, it's kind of interesting because the Maw intro gives you like almost a level of XP, like it's quite a big chunk of XP, and the Shadowlands Zone XP doesn't seem to be super abundant, so I've got to wonder if that's going to be iterated before release. So, there's that. Another thing, the potency conduit change. This is going to be a big change for the performance-oriented players, where basically they're making it so that there are 2 potency conduit slots per soul bind, and that is down from 3. Overall, less potency conduits on your character. Is this a nerf to conduit importance overall? I actually think it could be. I'd say, in my opinion, it's probably decent enough for these to be a bit less important, and it might make sense in the context of the next change we're going to cover in this video. Also, it should help to flatten out the problem of some, like, soul binds kind of getting more potency slots sooner than others, so there you go. They're iterating on that, and probably it will help them actually meet the goals that they laid out in their delay post. Then also, legendaries. Yes, Blizzard have actually made a post saying that their tuning targets for legendaries were too short, too weak, and they basically are going to be increasing them. So yes, your legendaries are getting a buff, and they'll be a more important part of your character. Now, in my opinion, conduits being less important and legendaries being more important is good, because legendaries are kind of like talents once you've unlocked them, and you can just swap them about at will to customize your gameplay. I think that is less restrictive and a lot more fun when it comes to building out your character, so I'm glad that they are actually getting increased prominence. The next up, a quick hit of class stuff. So Hunter's Mark actually has no longer got its damage component, but it is still in the GCD, and it really seems like it's now more about stuff like the stealth sight. Now here's the deal, okay? This sucked to use, because it basically just meant that before you did anything, you just had to hit a button to get 5% more damage. So it was just this really boring GCD that you had to use all the time. It did not add to gameplay. It was never an interesting decision or anything like that. It was just another GCD slapped on top of everything that sucked in target swapping situations. So this is a great change for the hunters. The next up for the rogues, Shadow Vault has been changed from a jumpy flippy thing to an explosive black powder that you sort of sprinkle on your enemies. Basically though, it no longer has a knock-up effect on your character, and overall, I think this is a pretty darn good change. The next up, an update on Henry Cavill Watch. Boss Logic has used the new Witcher promotional shots of, it's quite funny because it's Geralt there, and he's in one of those sort of like bit of armor that actually sculpts his abs even more, so that's quite something. But yeah, they've actually went and they have, they've touched it up to basically make that shot look like it's Arthas. Yes, another Henry Cavill Arthas. But this one seems to have actually got the attention of the man himself, who has liked it, seemingly on Instagram, and he added Blizzard. So there you go. Will Blizzard see this and make it happen? Will it ever happen? Could we see some Henry Cavill Arthas content, be it a movie, be it a TV show? Who knows? I mean, I'll say this. If fans really get the hots for this idea and people just campaign for it, I would say it could certainly get a few conversations started. It could certainly, you know, put a little spray of WD-40 on the initial shall we do this convos. Why not? I mean, would World of Warcraft work as a Witcher-sized sort of Witcher budget fantasy show? Very much could, right? Couldn't it? And I think Henry Cavill would be a pretty darn good choice, actually. Now, that said, you would then sort of think, would it be a bit awkward having Henry Cavill be both Geralt and Arthas? Would that be awkward? Maybe. Or would it be part of what? The Netflix horny fantasy universe? I think it would certainly work for that. I think there's a lot of people who would maybe see these shows as filling similar-ish niches. And The Witcher situation, like, The Witcher's pretty damn campy and, like, a bit crazy. I really enjoyed it, actually, even though it certainly has some production issues, and it has that fantasy trope that absolutely does my head in, where, for some reason, steel, like, you know, swords, can slice through body armor like butter, which is a little bit weird because, you know, blunt weapons actually existed to crush armor plating and things like that, so a sword doing that doesn't make that much sense. And that battle scene in the first episode was... Okay, I don't want to have a big moment with you, but I'll say this. I thought it was a pretty entertaining, enjoyable show, and it did get one thing completely right, and that was a whole bunch of the characters, so I thought that was pretty cool. And I think Henry Cavill did an absolutely fantastic job of being Geralt. I think he really nailed that. So, certainly the idea of a fantasy TV show at that budget getting a positive return on investment for a group like Netflix, well, that's been proven. Could it happen for Warcraft? Who knows? I certainly, I'll throw my hat in the ring. I'd like that to happen. Let's make it happen. Okay, finally, Naxxramas has hit the public test realm for WoW Classic. That's pretty big, actually. It's the final major patch to Classic, and if you want to watch a pretty long, in-depth video on what this patch actually meant, then you can check out our Naxxramas episode of the complete history of World of Warcraft, because it does cover that. As for what's to come next, well, that's bloody obvious, isn't it? It's going to be Classic TBC. Personally, I expect an announcement and reveal in February. I think that will almost certainly happen at the online edition of BlizzCon. I think we'll get a beta shortly after that, and I think that it will be ideally, in the sort of financials for Blizzard, the major World of Warcraft release of 2021. And I do think that's Blizzard's plan, a tick-tock between them, right? It's a pity now that whenever you say TikTok, people think of the social media app instead of how I see TikTok as being Intel's old CPU generation strategy. Anyway, ideally, I'd say Blizzard would want, you know, Modern Warcraft 1 year, Classic the next year, Modern the next year, you know, something like that. I do wonder, though, if we will get a World of Warcraft expansion in 2022. I have to imagine that's going to be Blizzard's goal, but of course Shadowlands will be a bit more late. So hard to say exactly what's going to go on there. But anyway, I think that's what's going to be going on for Classic. And really, that is it for today's episode, unless it's like some other episodes where every time I record something, something happens that changes it. I mean, we do the leveling guide, bam, it gets changed the next day. We do our video about, should Shadowlands be delayed? Bam, it gets delayed 4 hours later. The most recent episode of the WoW News that I recorded before this one, also, like, I recorded it and then bam, something happens. So maybe this one will be one and done. We'll have to see. Of course, if you want to support us and get a whole bunch of cool things that will arrive in this cool new, like, sort of card envelope that we designed, then hey, Patreon is the place. You guys have literally created, all your support over the last month. It's created 2 new jobs, and that's all going right back into the content for you. It's all pretty sweet. So thank you for the support. Thanks for watching this video. Let me know what you think about what we covered, and I will see you next time. Thank you.